Welcome to online worship at All Saints Episcopal Church in Chelmsford, Massachusetts. We also have in-person worship services here at the church. If you've been worshiping with us online during the pandemic but have never been here, I invite you to come and join us during one of those services. We'd love to meet you. The schedule for the services can be found right on the front page of our website. Otherwise, though, you're welcome to continue joining us in this way. So let's begin. Blessed be God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
And blessed be God's kingdom, now and forever. Amen.
Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name through Christ our Lord. Amen. Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. O God, you have taught us to keep all your commandments by loving you and our neighbor. Grant us the grace of your Holy Spirit that we may be devoted to you with our whole heart and united to one another with pure affection. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever.
A reading from the book of Ezekiel. The Lord said to me, O mortal, stand up on your feet, and I will speak with you. And when he spoke to me, a spirit entered into me and set me on my feet. And I heard him speaking to me. He said to me, Mortal, I am sending you to the people of Israel, to a nation of rebels who have rebelled against me. They and their ancestors have transgressed against me to this very day. The descendants are impudent and stubborn. I am sending you to them, and you shall say to them, Thus says the Lord God. Whether they hear or refuse to hear, for they are a rebellious house, they shall know that there has been a prophet among them. The word of the Lord. Psalm 123. To you I lift up my eyes, to you enthroned in the heavens. As the eyes of servants look to the hand of their masters, and the eyes of a maid to the hand of her mistress, so our eyes look to the Lord our God until he show us his mercy. Have mercy upon us, O Lord, have mercy. For we have had more than enough of contempt, too much of the scorn of the indolent rich, and of the derision of the proud.
Reading from the book of 2 Corinthians. I know a person in Christ who 14 years ago was caught up to the third heaven. Whether in the body or out of the body, I do not know. God knows. And I know that such a person, whether in the body or out of the body, I do not know. God knows. Was caught up into paradise and heard things that are not to be told, that no mortal is permitted to repeat. On behalf of such a one, I will boast, but on my own behalf, I will not boast, except of my weaknesses. But if I wish to boast, I will not be a fool, for I will be speaking the truth. But I refrain from it so that no one may think better of me than what is seen in me or heard from me, even considering the exceptional character of the revelations. Therefore, to keep me from being too elated, a thorn was given me in the flesh, a messenger of Satan to torment me, to keep me from being too elated. 3 times I appealed to the Lord about this, that it would leave me, but he said to me, "My grace is sufficient for you, for power is made perfect in weakness." So I will boast all the more gladly of my weaknesses, so that the power of Christ may dwell in me. Therefore, I am content with weaknesses, insults, hardships, persecutions, and calamities for the sake of Christ. For whenever I am weak, then I am strong. This is the word of the Lord.
The Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ, according to Mark.
Glory to you, Lord Christ.
Jesus came to his hometown, and his disciples followed him. On the Sabbath, he began to teach in the synagogue, and many who heard him were astounded. They said, "Where did this man get all this? What is this wisdom that has been given to him? What deeds of power are being done by his hands? Is not this the carpenter, the son of Mary, and the brother of James, and Joseph, and Judas, and Simon? And are not his sisters here with us?" And they took offense at him. Then Jesus said to them, "Prophets are not without honor, except in their hometown, and among their own kin, and in their own house." And he could do no deed of power there, except that he laid his hands on a few sick people and cured them. And he was amazed at their unbelief. Then he went about among the villages, teaching. He called the 12 and began to send them out 2 by 2 and gave them authority over the unclean spirits. He ordered them to take nothing for their journey except a staff, no bread, no bag, no money in their belts, but to wear sandals and not to put on 2 tunics. He said to them, "Wherever you enter a house, stay there until you leave the place. If any place will not welcome you, and they refuse to hear you, as you leave, shake off the dust that is on your feet as testimony against them." So they went out and proclaimed that all should repent. They cast out many demons and anointed with oil many who were sick and cured them. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
In the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. Today we read a surprising, heartbreaking story from the Gospel of Mark. It is the grand return of Jesus to Nazareth, his hometown. Rather than being greeted with acclaim or celebrated, we're told that the town's residents said things like, "Isn't this Jesus? Is not this the carpenter? The son of Mary, and brother of James, and Joseph, and Judas, and Simon? Are not his sisters here with us? They took offense at him. Jesus was amazed at their unbelief. Then Jesus said to them, "Prophets are not without honor, except in their hometown, and among their own kin, and in their own house." Well, why is this? After all, these people had more experience of Jesus than anyone else. They knew his family. They saw him grow up. They were in a better position than most anyone to experience what God was doing in him. To make matters worse, there's another story in the Gospel of Mark where there were rumors that Jesus was possessed by demons or had gone out of his mind, and his family was summoned to come and take Jesus away. What are we to think of these people on the wrong side of history, so to speak? How could they fail to recognize the one who was in their very midst? Were they just dense? It's important to note that these were not irreligious people. They were not without hope in God. They were merely people who could not see the great thing God was doing because it did not look like what they assumed it would. It was too close, too familiar, too embedded in what they thought they already knew. They were people who assumed that if God was going to do anything, it would be more grand and more impressive. It would be worthy of God, and that means it would be better than we know ourselves to be. Jesus says, "A prophet is not without honor, except in his hometown." Yet Christians from the beginning have often gone to great lengths to have an experience of God away from home. Think of the long tradition of pilgrimages to holy sites, whether it be to Canterbury, Jerusalem, Rome, or on a spiritual retreat somewhere like our own Barbara Harris camp. We like to find God away from home, do we not? If we are like the people Jesus grew up with, it is often easier to experience God truly in the unusual rather than in the everyday. I hope that you've done such things and had experience of God in places like that. That experiences of God tend to be confined to such places tells us more about ourselves than it tells us about God, who is not any more present in one place than in another. I mean, that we know. We too often live like it is a bit of a disappointment that we live our everyday lives as the people we are, where we are. The people of Nazareth seem to have thought, as Jesus was in their very midst, "Well, too bad we're not somewhere else, really, anywhere but here." Jesus was amazed. They were just offended. A prophet is not without honor, except in his hometown. I once took a trip to England to visit a British friend that I had met in the United States. I assumed I would have the best of all possible tour guides because he grew up there and would know what he was talking about. When I arrived to visit, I asked him about some of the sights to see. You know, he told me about which ones I should see. He had made any number of trips to the United States, loved the United States, was quite familiar with most of our country, and one would think that he would have toured his home country. Yet whenever I would ask him if he had been anywhere specific that I was going to, he would say, "Oh no, I haven't been there. I could go any time. Oh, those places, they're always around." I saw more of England in 3 weeks than he had in his lifetime. He said he knew parts of the United States better than some of the British towns that were just an hour away. Often we miss the good things in our life because of their mere proximity. They're too close and seem to be too easily had. For more than a year, nearly all of us were largely confined to our homes during the pandemic. We know better and more than most human beings do, how true Jesus' proclamation of the difficulty of finding God at home is. The limited venturing out that most of us have done and are doing right now, well, it's felt great, hasn't it? You may have already felt the joys of spiritual pilgrimage lately. The joy was palpable. You could feel it as we restarted our in-person Sunday morning Eucharists at All Saints. Some people have told me that they're finding going to the grocery store exciting these days, in person, picking out their own food without fear. Many things have become new to us again, and there's a lot of good in that. I don't imagine any of us will ever again take for granted Sunday morning worship together in church. There is opportunity here to renew and reappreciate much that we may have overlooked just because it was in our hometown. What is it that gets in the way of finding God in our hometown? St. Paul's letter is helpful here. The great Apostle Paul tells us an unusually personal story. He says that he had a thorn in his flesh, a messenger of Satan to torment him, to keep him from being, well, too arrogant. Speculations abound about what this really was. Was it, in the most literal sense, something tormenting about his flesh, that is, in his body? Something such as blindness or stuttering? Or was it something about his metaphorical flesh, something about his soul that he struggled with? He does not say. He does say, 3 times I appealed to the Lord about this and asked that it would leave me. But God said no. God seemed to prefer for Paul to have this lifelong struggle within himself. Paul wanted to be other than who he was, wanted to know God, but as someone else, or at least as a better version of himself, someone more than what he in fact was. Because God said no, he would need to find God in his hometown, where and who he had always been. There he was to learn what God meant by saying to him, "My grace is sufficient for you, for power is made perfect in weakness." Paul goes on to explain what this had come to mean for him. He says, "I will boast all the more gladly of my weakness now, so that the power of Christ may dwell in me. Therefore I am content with weaknesses, insults, hardships, persecutions, and calamities for the sake of Christ. For whenever I am weak, then I am strong." Well, why share a story this personal? Isn't it because St. Paul doesn't see Christianity as a religion of escape from the world, or from ourselves, or from our homes? It's not a religion of escape from reality. It is instead a religion of redemption, where the attention is on who we are, where we are now, and the discovery that there is always more there than meets the eye, even if it's nothing more than a grace that is sufficient for now. The moral teaching of the church is not just about doing the right thing or being the right kind of person. It is often more fundamentally about connecting with life, where we actually live. That is about finding God in our hometown. To find God in your own hometown, more often than not, requires daily acts of confession, forgiveness, of love, and acceptance. A part of each of us may, well, always be looking for something in this life that promises to transport us to a new place, kind of like a spiritual pilgrimage to a place far from home, or the equivalent of St. Paul praying to God to make him someone else. But what Christianity is, in fact, is something more powerful. It is redemption. It is the redemption of life that you are living, and not the escape from it. It is the experience of God in your hometown, where, well, where we already are. The change in this life is an awakening to the task of life where Jesus becomes visible to us in our Nazareth, exactly where we would have overlooked him before. This is why we worship with, well, water, bread and wine. There's nothing more everyday hometown than that. It makes it easy to say of all of it, like, well, is that it? Is this all? Which is the same sort of questions as, well, isn't this Jesus, the carpenter, the son of Mary? But that is the point. What we mean by sacrament is that God has the capacity to make himself known in the only things we can understand, the ordinary material objects of our lives, in the town we live in water, bread, and wine, in the busyness of our everyday lives, in our hopes, in our anxiety, and in our worry, in the family we find ourselves in the church we regularly worship in. All these things become more than they appear to be without ceasing to be what they are. And without ceasing to be who we are, we become more than we are. We find a grace that is sufficient. As each of us walks the streets of our own version of Nazareth, let us remind ourselves that God may seem far off by being too near to us, as near as our own breath. Let Nazareth, let that thorn in the flesh, let the water, bread, and wine become sacraments to you, as the whole world is redeemed and becomes not something to leave behind, but as an experience of grace. May the God whose omnipotence means that nothing is too ordinary or weak to manifest divine glory give us in Christ Jesus eyes not to look past what is most near to us, ears to hear what is whispered all around us, hearts to perceive what is right before us, so that through the Holy Spirit, we ourselves discover together with St. Paul that grace that is sufficient and that power that is made perfect in weakness. Amen.
Let us join together and confess our faith in the words of the Nicene Creed. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he became incarnate from the Virgin Mary and was made man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in accordance with the scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son. With the Father and the Son, he is worshiped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. The prayers of the people are in Form 5. In peace, let us pray to the Lord, for the Holy Church of God, that it may be filled with truth and love and be found without fault at the day of your coming. We pray to you, O Lord. For Michael, our presiding bishop, for Alan and Gail, our bishops, for Paul, our interim rector, and for Valerie Cowart, deacon, for all bishops and other ministers, and for all the holy people of God. We pray to you, O Lord. In the Anglican Communion, we also pray for the Anglican Church of Papua New Guinea. In our diocese, we pray for Church of Our Savior, Somerset, Christ Church, Swansea, the Young Adults Ministry Youth Council, Youth Leadership Academy, and all youth ministries, and for the Barbara C. Harris Camp and Conference Center. We also pray for the faith communities in Chelmsford, especially for Bethel Christian Church. We pray for those joining God's mission in our parish, especially for those serving as coffee hour hosts this summer. We pray to you, O Lord. For all who fear God and believe in you, Lord Christ, that our divisions may cease and that all may be one as you and the Father are one, we pray to you, O Lord. For all who, for the mission of the church, that in faithful witness it may preach the gospel to the ends of the earth, we pray to you, O Lord. For those who do not yet believe and for those who have lost their faith, that they may receive the light of the gospel, we pray to you, O Lord. For the peace of the world, that a spirit of respect and forbearance may grow among nations and peoples, we pray to you, O Lord. We pray for those in the armed forces and their families, especially for those who have been deployed overseas and for all others serving our country. We pray to you, O Lord. For those in positions of public trust, especially Joe, our president, and Charlie, our governor, that they may serve justice and promote the dignity and freedom of every person, we pray to you, O Lord. For a blessing upon all human labor and for the right use of the riches of creation, that the world may be freed from poverty, famine, and disaster, we pray to you, O Lord. For the poor, the persecuted, the sick, and all who suffer, for refugees, prisoners, and all who are in danger, that they may be relieved and protected, we pray to you, O Lord. For this congregation, that we may be delivered from hardness of heart and show forth your glory in all that we do, we pray to you, O Lord. For ourselves, for the forgiveness of our sins, and for the grace of the Holy Spirit to amend our lives, we pray to you, O Lord. For all who have commended themselves to our prayers, for our families, friends, and neighbors, that being freed from anxiety, they may live in joy, peace, and health, we pray to you, O Lord. Those who have commended themselves to our prayers in need of healing are Amy, Linda, Molly, Nate, and Garrett. For family and friends of our parishioners, John and family, Chris, Dan, Brian, and Kristen, Ruth Ellen, Christine, Diana, Robert, Vicky, and Judy. We pray for those who are at home in nursing homes or living with chronic illnesses, for Terry, Chaz, Jeanette, Larry, Ken, Catherine, Garrett, and Ginny. We pray to you, O Lord, for all who have died in the communion of your church and those whose faith is known to you alone, that with all the saints, they may have rest in that place where there is no pain or grief, but life eternal. We pray to you, O Lord.
On this 4th of July, we pray for our country. O God, you made us in your image and redeemed us through Jesus, your Son. Look with compassion on the whole human family. Take away the arrogance and hatred which infect our hearts. Break down the walls that separate us. Unite us in bonds of love, and work through our struggle and confusion to accomplish your purposes on earth, that in your good time all nations and races may serve you in harmony around your heavenly throne. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. O Lord our God, accept the fervent prayers of your people. In the multitude of your mercies, look with compassion upon us and all who turn to you for help. For you are gracious, O lover of souls, and to you we give glory. Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, now and forever. Amen. Let us confess our sins against God and our neighbor. Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you, in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry, and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your name. Amen. Almighty God, have mercy upon you, forgive you all your sins through our Lord Jesus Christ, strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit keep you in eternal life. Amen. The peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, let us pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Almighty God, our fast from Holy Communion does not arise out of any lack of devotion to you, but out of the love you have commanded that we have for one another. Give us strength to endure and bless this fast, so that our spiritual hunger will lead us to worship you as one family, once again gathered around your altar, where with your Son, Jesus Christ, you live and reign with the Holy Spirit, one God, unto ages of ages. Amen.
And the peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God. And the blessing of God the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be upon you this day and remain with you always. Let us go forth into the world rejoicing in the power of the Holy Spirit.
Thanks be to God.